I beat Mega Man 11 in one sitting without taking any damage. And not only that, with the completion of this game, I have finished each of the 12 classic Mega Man games without taking any damage. Each had their own strict rule set, and each one was performed live on Twitch. This video is going to have two sections. The first will review Mega Man 11's run by briefly examining the gameplay mechanics and the routing for the run, then reviewing the winning run. The second section will be a sweeping review of the entire no damage effort for this series. We'll do some comparisons of the games, including things like their overall difficulty, the most challenging individual situations and boss fights, and more. Let's get into Mega Man 11. Mega Man 11 was released in 2018 on multiple platforms. I performed this run on the Switch, but all versions are functionally the same across platforms. Mega Man 11 brings back the slide and charge buster to Mega Man's kit and has a few new mechanics. The most notable is the new gear system, which gives Mega Man the ability to use power gear to power up his weapons and speed gear to slow down time. These were controlled with the shoulder bumper buttons, at least with my setup on console. Both gears have a shared meter, and staying in either for too long results in a punishing burnout where neither can be used for a while. Power gear causes sub-weapons to emit an advanced, more powerful version of the weapon. Importantly, the player only needs to go into power gear for a very short amount of time to launch a power sub-weapon, then they can quickly deactivate power gear to preserve most of the meter. Many of the power gear variants of the sub-weapons are incredibly powerful, most notably Tundra Storm, Blazing Torch, and Chain Blast. Speed gear is the other gear, and is the ultimate utility ability for a run like this. The player slows down time and can react fluidly to difficult situations, for which this game can throw many at the player. It can be toggled on or off without any penalty, but once again, activating it for too long will result in burnout, and without speed gear, many situations in this game can become very dangerous. Getting used to toggling the gear system in this game is one of the biggest challenges for learning how to play efficiently, but once you do, the setup is incredibly powerful for both dishing out damage and maneuvering dangerous situations. Another mechanic introduction is the ability to weapon swap with the right stick on console. This is very convenient for getting the exact weapon you want. Typically in Mega Man games with the weapon swapping mechanic, you have to remember both the order of the weapons using the LR buttons to scroll, and you also have to keep track of which weapons you have access to at different points in the game. With this new weapon swapping system, you can directly choose the weapon you want every time. The very large downside is that flicking the stick can result in undesirable inputs, and there were many times where I weapon swapped to the wrong weapon entirely while in a stressful situation, and took a hit as a result of it. The L and R button system works as usual in this game though, so the player has to choose which they prefer. I ended up using a hybrid approach, sometimes using the stick and sometimes using L and R to swap. Otherwise, Mega Man 11 follows the classic Mega Man formula. You have robots to start, a set of castle stages, the refight stage, and then the final boss. In this game, the A Robot Master stages are fairly lengthy, but the castle stages are relatively few and short compared to the other Mega Man games. The rules for Mega Man 11 were consistent with the other entries in this series I completed without taking damage, with a few extra notes. The standard no glitches, no death, and no damage rules apply. This game has a built-in turbo function for Buster, which I did not allow. I felt it was unnecessary and took away from some of the challenge. Further, I disallowed shopping in this game. The shop gives the player the ability to buy W-tanks, which allow Mega Man to restore all of his weapon ammo. This game gives the player a ton of bolts, which are this game's currency, for relatively low effort. If you watch any speedruns of this game, you'll see that they typically go to the shop and buy many W-tanks to breeze by the stages. I also felt this took away from the challenge, so I disallowed the shop entirely. There are some other cool upgrades that you can buy at the shop, but I felt it was too arbitrary to just disallow W-tank purchases, and I settled on not allowing shopping at all. And as always, abusing the pause menu is not allowed. Simply put, an honest playthrough of the game without taking damage performed by me in real time on a Switch controller. For this segment, we're going to cover both the routing and the run review together. This game is ultimately not very complicated for routing purposes. The majority of the challenge comes from mastering the controls, which takes a lot of practice. But the run itself is fairly easy to understand, so we'll review it all together. The run starts out in Tundra Man stage. With just the Buster, the gear system gets a lot of immediate use. Speed gear helps mash down enemies with more health like the Crunch Don, and also helps navigate narrow situations like with the Gabule and the Propeller IT enemies. Every Robot Master stage in this game has a mini-boss. Up first is Mecha Mammelstall. While using the power gear to charge a double buster, the meter must be managed very carefully to avoid burnout. Speed Gear helps navigate the ice swan's projectiles and also a claustrophobic room with the propeller eye T enemies. Tundra Man awaits at the end and is easily clearable with the Mega Buster. This boss shows off how all Robot Masters themselves have either a Power or Speed Gear Desperation mode. Tundra Man's Speed Gear is combated with Mega Man's own, and well-timed shots and spacing make easy work of him. This boss will always do the same pattern in the same order, which mostly trivializes the fight. Tundra Man was chosen first both because of how reasonable his stage is with Buster only, but also for how incredibly powerful his weapon is, Tundra Storm. Impact Man comes next. Although Impact Man is not the next in the weakness order, the stage is relatively dangerous, and the boss is fought with Buster anyway. Tundra Storm will help a lot in this stage too, so it's a natural second stage. Speed Gear helps handle the first descent and catch the bottom platform on the first cycle. The stage features huge rooms with a lot of homing attacks, so a combination of Speed Gear and Tundra Storm help a lot. Charged Tundra Storm is a full screen clear, which is incredibly powerful. It does cost 7 weapon energy, which is 1/4 of the meter. Planning out where to use Tundra Storms in each stage was a huge part of the routing for this game. Patient play helps clean up this stage, and the mini-boss, Pikmin Digger, is a scripted fight. Just don't mess up. The huge platform conveyor screen is definitely scary at first glance, but having Tundra Storm for this screen makes it very achievable to get through. Still, it takes practice to do all of this consistently. One more ascent using Speed Gear and Rush Coil, then it's off to the boss. Impact Man will take 4 actions, either jumping or charging at Mega Man into a wall, then will go into a 3-spike pattern. If at any time he falls below a health threshold, he will go into an invincible phase for a while. The fight is a little scary, but with some practice and pattern awareness, it's quite reasonable to clear consistently with just the Buster. Power Gear Charge Buster does 8 damage, which is a huge amount, and he goes down. Torchman's the upcoming stage. Impact Man's Pile Driver weapon will get immediate use, which is a great utility weapon for going fast and bypassing parts of the screen. You will start to see why I disallowed buying W tanks from the shop with this weapon. You can easily bypass many parts of this game by using Pile Driver non-stop. This is an ultimate patience stage. Don't play too hasty and things generally will work out fine. Speed Gear helps navigate the firewall segments with a breeze. The mini-boss, Sparky, can be defeated very quickly with Tundra Storm, but because we need it for the boss fight, I opt to Buster it down. With Speed Gear and some manual mashing, it's easily defeated. The W tank in this stage is retrieved, which will be one of 3 W tanks retrieved in this run. More Speed Gear and careful navigating, then it's off to the boss. Torchman is one of the most dangerous robot masters. He moves incredibly fast. He fires one fist, then either fires 2 more, moves towards the player, or does a very dangerous jump kick. Using Speed Gear helps the player decide what to do, but it all happens very quickly, and it's critically important to not go into gear burnout. My strategy was to land 1 Tundra Storm, assess the situation with Speed Gear, and then pivot. After 2 Tundra Storms, he goes into Power Gear mode, and the fight is mostly trivial from here. Last Man's Theme Park Adventure awaits. The player has to be careful of all the explosive boxes in the stage, as they will cause damage. Speed Gear is especially helpful for dealing with the fire server enemies, as their projectile can be very dangerous when launched at Mega Man. Generally getting close to them and sliding through them after their defeat is safe. Another W tank is retrieved, then the mini-boss, Thrill Twins, get deleted by a Power Tundra Storm into a regular one. Blazing Torch is used in the stage, and is another one of this game's most useful weapons. It has a piercing mechanic, and its charge version attacks over a wide range. Pile Driver helps clear the Fire Server and Sniper Armor D room. The room with all of the Shimobis is a great example of saving Tundra Storm for the right situation. Without Tundra Storm, this would be a chaotic mess. One final climb with Rush Coil, and it's off to the boss. Blast Man has some variance in his patterns, but Speed Gear helps land 3 quick Blazing Torches on him. Using Blazing Torch to both clear his own projectiles and also deal damage is the best way to navigate the first part of the fight. Once he's in Power Gear mode, a well-timed charge Blazing Torch cleaves through his projectiles and deals damage to him, and then a final hit with Speed Gear ends the fight. Off to Block Man stage, one of this game's longer stages. Power Pile Driver gets huge value on the Crunch Don enemies, and Power Blazing Torch helps pierce the Mawaru Sea enemies too. There are 2 sets of the mini-boss Totemer in this stage. Both are fought with a power chain blast, and two quick hits make easy work of the first one. Chain blast helps bypass the stone maze section. Because this Robot Master stage is fifth, the player has access to Rush Jet, which helps in screens like these. I narrowly avoid a bad situation with the Mararu Sea here, which happened because I didn't realize the enemy will actively respawn. Not all enemies do. The second Totemer takes place on a conveyor. The strategy is mostly the same, but a well-timed jump between power chain blasts help avoid damage and pass time between the weapon shot cooldown. Careful play and Thunderstorm help clear the end of the stage. Because of how often chain blast was used in the stage, I opted to use a W tank for this stage to refill for the boss. I thought long about where W tanks were most useful, and because weapon energy is refilled between the Wily stages, I felt they were most useful in the longer Robot Master stages like this one. Blockman is the same fight every time. Deal some damage, trigger his power gear phase, then well-timed power chain blast cleave through his health. It's time for Hopsercise at Bounce Man's Boing Boing Park. This is the longest Robot Master stage, and it's a gauntlet. The stage requires having a good handle on weapon energy, and a W tank is used later in this stage too. The Bunbee balloon enemies should be taken out via their balloons to avoid extra projectiles, and the Boyoran enemies are actually quite chaotic and best taken out immediately with a power chain blast. Both Rush Coil and Jet get a lot of use in this stage. Everyone's favorite mini boss, Frog Balloon, shows up twice. The strategy is the same for both, but the first is a little easier. This mini boss is very weak to Pile Driver, but it comes at a huge risk of Mega Man taking recoil damage, so I opted for other sub-weapons and using Thunderstorm to safely clear the spawned Boyorns. This is the ultimate patient stage, tested by the Tosinizer 5 enemies in these corridors. For Frog Balloon 2, carefully starting off with Speed Gear ensures the first Power Blazing Torch goes off, then Pump Master K goes down just like before. The final climb is yet another test of patience, but it almost always plays out the same. A final W tank is acquired here, and will be a backup for later in this run. Bounce Man's fight underwent a lot of iterations in my preparation for this challenge, but I settled on this one. Immediately land a power pile driver, then clear the screen with power Thunderstorm. Afterwards, a well-timed power pile driver into specifically a non-power pile driver clears the fight. As noted before, pile driver sometimes causes recoil damage, so it must be handled very carefully. But it undoubtedly is the best tool for this fight. Fuse Man stage is another fairly claustrophobic stage, and it's important to have a consistent game plan for every screen. The beginning laser screens showcase how the player must be very careful about navigating. Speed Gear helps a lot though. This large horizontal screen underwent many changes for weapon energy routing, but taking it safe and slow was the best way. Bounce Ball takes out the Elec Crosser and Elec Extender enemies easily. A lot of this stage comes down to assessing the situation, playing calmly and not getting distracted, more than others. The mini boss is destroyed by two well-placed bounce ball attacks, then specifically a power bounce ball attack to finish. Ordinarily, there's a limit for how many bounce ball attacks can be out at once, but the power bounce ball allows one extra and is enough to finish the fight. That being said, I messed it up a little in this fight and was close to burnout, but narrowly survived. Thunderstorm helps clear the baton enemies with its armor-piercing capabilities. Speed Gear is instrumental in these final few screens. Fuse Man opens the same way every time, walk towards him, then land the first bounce ball. After that, my approach was extremely unscientific. Launch a bunch of bounce balls and navigate around the room safely. His Speed Gear form comes out fast, but it's fine as long as you keep moving, and eventually enough bounce ball attacks will defeat him. Almost every boss fight in this entire no damage challenge had some level of sophistication to it, but this one I embraced the chaos and just let the bounce balls rip and hope it worked out, which it usually did. And finally, Acid Man stage. This is a partially underwater stage, but Speed Gear helps a ton like usual. Bounce Ball clears the Pipetto enemies, and regular Buster Shots take out the underwater Brushy enemies. This long horizontal screen took some careful planning, but ultimately well-timed power Thunderstorms helped a lot. The mini-boss, Cyclone W, is completely helpless against two power Block Droppers. Block Dropper is a powerful weapon, and I acquire it relatively late in the run, but in another world where Blockman was earlier in the route, it could see a lot more use. Some well-timed pile drivers cleared the screen, and I almost had a panic near the end, but a power chain blast clears the final threat in this room. The final underwater bout looks scary, but it's really not so hard once the player knows where to jump, as most of the time a fully committed jump is safe with proper spacing. Rush Coil helps underwater for a big and safe boost, then it's off to the boss. Acid Man is the same fight every time. Land 3 power block droppers, then use speed gear to navigate around his own speed gear and squeeze in some regular block droppers. This fight really showcases the power of the duality of the gear system. It's off to the castle stages. Wily 1 is a long and difficult stage with risk of death, and it took a lot of practice to work out a safe and reliable strategy, maximizing weapon energy. Again, weapon energy is restored between stages, so there's no reason to hold back. Chain Blast ammo must be preserved for the boss, but otherwise anything goes. Both Wily 1 and 2 have a lot of weapon ammo scattered throughout the stages, too. Charged Pile Driver gets a lot of use, especially at the start, and Charged Tundra Storm helps with the elusive Air Nut enemies. Well-timed Pile Drivers bypass parts of the stage, and keeping it full on ammo helps a lot. I use Rush Jet in this stage, and the intent was to save some for the boss, but in this run I overspent. Block Dropper sees some usage with the K-Drone and Wall Blasters to clear enemies in a safe range in front of Mega Man. This horizontal screen was one of the scariest in the game, and quick and accurate weapon swapping is imperative for clearing. I use a little visual cue for aligning this jump and the spike descent to allow me to buffer directions between screen transitions. Pile Driver sees some more use, and speed gear used with Rush Jet helps trivialize an otherwise difficult platforming section. Yellow Devil is back. The classic pattern reappears, but speed gear helps navigate it nicely. After the first power chain blast, the intent is to Rush Jet over the second phase, but I was low so I had to dodge it instead, which was a little scary. The boss's speed gear phase is the same every time, and well-placed power chain blasts and consistent jumping results in victory. A note about this game's mechanics. There is a chance of your input getting entirely dropped during a specific part of Mega Man's movement, specifically when he is turning around while walking. During practice, it was most problematic while dodging this boss's speed gear phase. I worked on my movement to try to avoid a situation for which that would occur, and it worked out. You didn't think one of Mega Man 6's jankiest mechanics was going to come back, did you? Next up is Wily 2. This is also a fairly lengthy stage, but a slight step down in difficulty. You have more time to safely navigate each room, and patient play is rewarded. In this stage in particular, you start to feel the full power of Mega Man's toolkit in this game. Charged sub-weapons get a lot of use here. Detonating a chain blast on the Gabuol enemies defeats them, which makes things much safer. Blazing Torch's piercing capabilities help a lot early on, and the large cylinder sentries are deleted immediately with a power chain blast. The Sniper Joe room gets cleared easily with a Power Tundra Storm, and the rarely seen Power Scramble Thunder. You could easily use a different sub-weapon here, but I had to give it some respect. The Pressed On section is handled nicely with another rarely seen weapon, Power Acid Barrier, which has a decently damaging projectile that helped here. After a final climb with speed gear, the boss awaits. Malvern ended my previous run, and I was ready for vengeance. Malvern opens its core after taking enough hits, then will close again after either enough damage or enough time. The flow of the fight is to open its core, just barely bypassing its projectile in its close phase, then score two hits with Bounce Ball. Speed gear helps navigate this fight, but because of the sporadic nature of Bounce Ball, sometimes you can accidentally open the core early and it can heavily derail you. After enough damage, it goes into a power gear phase. It's very important to scout where it's going to spawn with speed gear, because it can absolutely teleport directly on you. It will repeat this teleport in 3-time laser attack, but scouting with speed gear and landing bounce balls in its core results in victory. It's one of this game's most unruly fights, but it's also fun to master. Wily 3, the classic stage, the refight stage. After a short corridor with the fire server enemies, it's off to the refights. I opt to fight Torchman first because of some weapon ammo routing. The idea is to use 3 power tundra storms, then 1 uncharged tundra storm, which leaves just enough ammo for one more power tundra storm for another fight. Torchman gives me the ultimate mix-up with a high jump kick, and I even go into burnout in this fight, but I narrowly stayed alive. A very scary fight to start. Bounceman's next, and the saved power tundra storm is used here. Afterwards, the refights play out pretty normally, and for the most part there aren't any real stressful situations, with the exception of Tundra Man, who in theory should be quite easy. I missed one of the scramble thunders. Then I began to scramble myself and was incredibly close to getting hit by his speed gear attack. I narrowly dodged and I moved on. Wily Forward, the final stage. After a conveyor section with some propeller IT enemies, it's off to Wily Machine. This fight opens with a charged chain blast, then activating a power acid barrier. Acid barrier is incredibly good in this fight, both as a damaging projectile and as an actual shield. It absorbs all projectiles from this boss, and the only concern is monitoring when the barrier is going to expire. In this fight, it expired literally as I defeated the first phase. Ideally, the acid barrier is re-upped right before the phase switch, but it's not a huge deal. Wily Capsule is the most dangerous at the beginning of the fight. He can fly around up to 3 times and then attack with some fairly dangerous gear projectiles. The goal is to squeeze in hits with power acid barrier as much as possible, but ultimately to scout for when the gear projectiles are coming and immediately clear them with power tundra storm. In this fight, I had to very carefully manage my speed gear meter to avoid burnout, which I narrowly did. Once Capsule goes into double gear mode, it actually becomes much easier because his movements are completely scripted. One final hit of acid barrier and the fight is won. My final thoughts on Mega Man 11 for this challenge is that this game takes a lot of time to practice and to master the controls. Truly, there's a lot to manage when picking up this game, between the weapon swapping, the new gear system, and managing all your resources. But once you start to pick up on the mechanics, Mega Man feels more powerful than ever. In particular, Speed Gear is such an incredibly powerful tool for this challenge, to be able to scout situations. It just takes a while getting used to operating in time slowdown and managing its meter. I finished Mega Man 11's No Damage Challenge within 2 live streams, which was way, way faster than I was expecting. But all the practice paid off, and with that, every one of the classic Mega Man games was completed without taking damage. Now, it's time to talk about the whole No Damage Challenge for the classic Mega Man series. From May 2022 until March 2024, I spent the majority of my time playing games dedicated to clearing classic Mega Man games without taking damage. After being a speedrunner for a very long time, I decided to take a long break from it and try something else, and this is what I came up with. People have been doing No Damage Challenges for a long time, but for Mega Man, there wasn't a lot of material out there for No Damage playthroughs, and we'll talk about some of the content out there later. Naturally, these games are fairly difficult, and even more difficult to clear without taking any damage. But I had a lot of experience speedrunning pretty much every classic Mega Man game except for Mega Man 11 at the time, so I felt I could get started without too many barriers of entry, and I jumped in. Let's talk about some big picture concepts with this kind of challenge. Ultimately, it's hard. It's hard for many reasons to complete this challenge. Mega Man games are full of enemies, projectiles, and difficult boss encounters, and in particular, dealing with randomness and executing on demand. But without limitations via the rules for playing these games in a challenge scenario, you can easily bypass the difficulty for a lot of the scenarios. For example, allowing the player to press pause in any situation they want can trivialize playing the game. If pressing pause to basically pause buffer any difficult situation was allowed, then every run would turn into a press pause spam fest anytime things got difficult. That doesn't mean that you can just ban pausing, because in many games it's necessary to swap weapons. There's a level of good faith that goes into setting this kind of rule, and if you watched any of my live runs, you should know that the rules in place, just like this one, were for keeping the playthroughs as honest and normal as possible. No deaths, no damage, no major glitches to bypass sections of the game, no pause abuse. For all accounts, an honest attempt at reasonably playing the game. Each one of these games took a substantial amount of practice. There are a few difficult aspects. First and foremost is technical mastery. You simply just have to play the game a lot and get good. You need to understand each game's nuanced mechanics, for which every single Mega Man game handles a little differently, even if they look similar. Everything from movement, how the pause menu works, how each weapon works, how the enemies behave and respawn, on and on. Another very difficult part of doing these runs is nerves management. When doing live attempts, getting better and better at the game starts to add to the pressure of actually completing the game without taking damage. I generally feel I'm pretty good at managing my nerves and attitude when on a good run, but it's exceptionally hard near the end of a run that has a real chance to finish. I'll comment on this shortly, but this is what separates players and lends legitimacy to doing the challenge. You have to play in a way that is a combination of safe and efficient, while not making critical mistakes, and especially in a Mega Man game, a small mistake can end it all immediately. Another particular challenge is figuring out how to practice and prepare efficiently. This might seem obvious, but it's very easy to fall into practice patterns where you don't exactly do all the same strategies you would do during a live run. The most important part is to practice in a realistic way that you will try to replicate during live runs, and also to play during live runs in a way that you practice, and to not scramble or pivot too much. It's better to mess up and take damage in a live run because of something you practice not being the best strategy, than it is to fumble around without a game plan and ignoring the practice you put in. For the most part, I wouldn't look at other people's runs before starting the challenge of any individual game, because I enjoyed the routing and creative process to figure it all out. After I finished a run, I would see what was out there. There aren't that many people that have done runs of these games, and to be honest with you, what's out there is a complete mess. I will not be calling anyone out specifically, because ultimately the concrete proof to condemn anyone is very difficult to obtain. But there are many quote-unquote runs out there that are fairly obviously either edited runs that were not performed in real time, or they are runs performed with emulator and re-recording tools, aka not actual runs done by a player in a single sitting. Further, let's talk about what makes this challenge difficult. It's stringing together the entirety of the run in one sitting. All the scenarios that can result in taking damage back-to-back in a run. The real intense pressure of finishing the final stretch of a game while carrying the rest of the run on your back. You have to have a game plan for any situation and be ready for executing it on demand. Some of the content out there that has to do with single stages without taking damage in an edited playlist or quote-unquote boss rush videos where someone splices together a bunch of footage of individual bosses without taking damage, we're talking about two completely different universes of difficulty. For example, being able to complete any boss in any Mega Man game without taking damage on demand is the bare minimum for getting a winning run for any individual game, and doing it once and uploading a recording is in my mind completely trivial. This isn't to demean someone who is proud of doing some challenge and posting some videos about it, that's perfectly fine, but we are talking about two different worlds of difficulty. The area that actually bothers me is when runs are passed off implicitly as if they were done by a person. There is no central verification body on people's runs. No proof necessary for what's out there on YouTube or other video sites. Some of the videos out there are just blatantly not done by a human being. It's preying upon viewers' expectation. The viewer expects that the uploader has good faith, but I can tell you as someone who both has gone through the process of trying to do it themselves and watching other people that have tried to do it live, there is a night and day kind of approach that goes into the way the player handles situations and controls the game. When you watch Mega Man fly around the screen and do completely unsafe and incomprehensible strategies, specifically strategies that a person that was trying to complete a run safely and consistently would never do, the red flags are raised. On the flip side, it's pretty obvious when someone is doing this kind of challenge legit. For example, after I finished Mega Man 3, I looked around for others that did Mega Man 3 as well. There were some attempts at the endeavor, but the one that jumped out to me was the user GameChamp3000's Mega Man 3 Journey. They had years of VODs of all of their attempts at this one specific game, showing off the grueling journey that is completing Mega Man 3 without taking damage. They did a full review of the game afterwards, and for all intents and purposes, showed both that it's possible to be done and that they specifically did do it. That to me is real, there's no deceit. And I'll leave the topic here, but I think that there are many videos out there that are not as genuine and attempt to either subtly fool or actively fool people into thinking that it's a real and genuine playthrough done by a human when it's not. Now let's switch topics. Let's discuss the five biggest challenges of the entire endeavor. The enemies of the stream. Individual games may or may not be comparatively difficult, but certain situations required so much practice and were genuinely terrifying in their runs. Almost any situation could be handled in practice with a save state fairly reasonably, but showing up during the run for some of these situations and performing correctly was just hard. Number 5 on this list is Rockman 2's Airman fight. Airman's air shooter patterns are nearly impossible to dodge by simply jumping, but it is technically possible. However, gambling your run on what can be down to a frame-perfect input is unreasonable, considering you have to fight Airman twice. Instead, an interesting technique is used, where standing on an item 1 will allow the player to halt the air shooter projectiles. It's flashy, but it's also really hard to control the timing and spacing of the whole endeavor. Because this fight appears late in the run, the pressure is enormous to overcome landing the strategy not only once but twice. The silver lining is that once the air shooters are dodged and Airman switches sides, the fight is trivial. Number 4 goes to Mega Man 8's CC Roll. CC Roll shows up fairly early on in this game's run, but it's one of the most technically demanding, claustrophobic fights in the entire series to do without taking damage. Between the giant mini-boss, the small arena, two types of enemy cohorts it can spawn, and the way it bounces around the room, the whole fight requires extremely precise use of different sub-weapons, including Tornado Hold and Ice Wave for enemy clearing, and Mega Ball and Flash Bomb for dealing real damage to the boss. Further, the mini CC Rolls will change speed based on how low CC Roll's health is. A truly chaotic fight. Number 3 is Airman. Again? This time it's the Doc Airman fight in Mega Man 3. Somehow, Airman returns, and even though the fight is completely different, it's somehow even more challenging. The general idea is that because some patterns are so brutal on timing, and one particular pattern is quite literally not possible to dodge without Rush Jet is required to safely navigate the situation and scout. Depending on which patterns he gives you, Mega Man can sometimes narrowly squeeze in some spark shocks, but being back on Rush Jet for the otherwise undodgeable pattern is a hard requirement to being able to complete this fight consistently. After Airman switches sides, it's still a scramble to finish the fight before he starts firing again. This fight requires excellent pattern awareness and decision making. Slash Man is squarely the number 2 slot. The fact that this fight isn't number 1 says a lot, because it truly is ridiculous. While Slash Man is fighting Mega Man on the ground, it's a pretty standard fight, and easy enough to avoid damage with some practice and understanding. But when he jumps on the ceiling, that's where it all goes down. He will drop red goop on Mega Man, and has a number of awful properties, including forcing the player to not be able to attack if it lands on Mega Man's head, or forces the player to not move if Mega Man makes contact with it on the ground. Mega Man also can't slide while gooped. Mashing out of the goop status is possible, but incredibly hard to do quickly while trying to dodge the very chaotic boss that will slash you. The number one hardest part about this fight is how non-telegraphed the goop pattern is. It just comes down extremely fast, and there are multiple of them per cycle, and you just gotta game out of your mind to deal with it. Further, you have to fight this guy twice, which is the cherry on top. An all-around ridiculously difficult encounter and the killer of many runs. The number one enemy of the stream, Mega Man 3's Doc Quickman. Without any shadow of a doubt, this is the hardest encounter in the whole series. Nothing is even close, not even Slash Man. I recommend you watch the Mega Man 3 routing and run video for a full breakdown, but Doc Quickman has some of the most chaotic, untelegraphed patterns possible, on top of having an insanely intimidating projectile attack that tracks Mega Man's position. The combination of his movement and his projectiles make the fight nearly unwinnable. The only saving grace in this fight is that you can intentionally lag the game to slow down the game and make certain situations reactable, but even this takes a metric ton of practice to consistently do on demand. I spent so much time practicing Doc Quickman when I was playing this game. I probably practiced this fight alone more than I practiced the entirety of Mega Man 1. There were days where I'd practice for 30 minutes and have like a 20% win rate. It's just out of control. Now, we're gonna do some comparisons of the games, so let's do a difficulty ranking. We'll go through each game in release order and put them on a scale of most to least difficult and discuss the run. As a reminder, every game has its own dedicated routing and run review video if you'd like many more details about each one of these games. And you can watch all of the VODs of each game's attempts. Check this video's description for those playlist links. But now it's time to compare them all. Mega Man 1 is up first. This game is the shortest of all Mega Man games, and even though it is at times janky and held together by glue and rubber bands, this game's length and relative simplicity of mechanics make it on the slightly easier side. There are some dangerous encounters, like the end of the refight section in Wily 4, but this game is pretty reasonable, especially with how good Thunderbeam is. A shorter game simply means it takes less effort to make it all the way to the end with the run on your back. So this one ends up being one of the easier entries overall. Rockman 2, Mega Man 2's difficult mode counterpart, is next. This game is also on the shorter side, and the special weapons are generally better than the first game, including everyone's favorite Metal Blade. The Airman fight in this game alone amps up the difficulty, and there are some specific cases like Airman, Quickman, and Boo Beam Trap where certain techniques are basically required to complete them consistently, which takes a lot of time and preparation. Wily Machine is also pretty scary in this game, and a well-timed Clash Bomb is crucial for a no-damage clear. The final boss is pretty simple though, and it winds up barely on the easier side of the spectrum. Mega Man 3. There's no debate, no question at all, this is the hardest challenge and it's not even close. It not only has the single hardest encounter, Doc Quickman, it's filled with tons of other challenging encounters like Doc Airman, and overall the refights are scary in close quarters. The Doc Robot stages are just all around hard too. Rush Jet is perhaps at its most powerful in this game, and it's a big asset. But really, no other game comes close. This was the single biggest achievement of the whole campaign. There were days where I wasn't sure I was ever going to finish this one. Mega Man 4, however, was the easiest game. The title of the easiest game could be up for debate, but it comes down to a few things. Mega Man 4 gives you not only one, but two full-screen clear sub-weapons, Rain Flush and Time Stopper, and Time Stopper in particular is one of the best weapons in the whole series. Most Robot Masters have very easy to assess patterns for not taking damage. Met Daddy is this game's hardest battle, and with some clever balloon usage, even that isn't too bad. The whole game is mostly just safe. Notably, this game doesn't really have much jank to it. It sorta just functions normally, which you would think would be a baseline, but especially on the NES, it's a mixed bag. Mega Man 5 is right next to it, one of the easiest games in the series. Mega Man in this game is extremely powerful, with his Mega Buster arguably being the best it's ever been. With Super Arrow to cleave through the stages and Robot Master fights being fairly linear, there are only a few situations where the player really has to react and perform on the fly, including Big Pets and Wily 1. But even in situations like those, some tools like Star Shield and Gravity Hold help so much. Despite Mega Man 4 and 5 having two sets of four castle stages, they end up being not big threats at all. Mega Man 6, however, is a different story. Some parts of this game are relatively smooth, but Mega Man 6 notably has a very different feeling engine, including the well-known difference in not being able to jump out of a slide. This mostly isn't a problem when you get used to playing this game, but it does take getting used to. The biggest issue with this game is having eaten inputs during landing and turning around in some situations, which is truly awful when trying to be very precise. Some Robot Masters like Tomahawk Man and Yamato Man just come at you fast, and dealing with it all on the fly is just tough. Even some of the tools like Power Suit and Jet Suit are very good, but also hard to master, and in some ways limit your damage potential hugely, so it's a very particular kind of game. This game makes it to the harder side of the series. Mega Man 7. What a game it is for this challenge. The overall theme for Mega Man 7 is that it's mostly not that difficult except for when it is, and then it is extremely difficult. Many stages in this game are very reasonably cleared. There are a few challenging parts, like King Gojulas in the Dinosaur Unit, and some platforming like in Turbo Man stage, but really, it's the Slash Man show. This boss is just out of control, and the fact that you have to fight him twice, especially at the very end of the game, makes the game so much harder to complete. On top of all of that, Wily Capsule is widely known as one of the hardest Wily Capsule fights in the series, and a very, very particular method of using Rush Coil is used to dodge and defeat him, and it's never really safe. This is squarely the second most difficult game in the series to me. Mega Man 8 is a game I've had a ton of experience with. Ultimately, it's a beast of a game, and it's the longest game in terms of time when comparing speedrun times. There are two sections of every Robot Master stage, and four fairly lengthy castle stages. You're given the fantastic utility tool Mega Ball, but between difficult mini-bosses like CC Roll and Garone, on top of Robot Masters with huge variants in patterns in narrow fighting areas like Searchman, it's an all-around just tough game. I think if I didn't have years of speedrun experience with this game, it would have taken even longer than it did, and this one still took quite a few live streams to finish. I rank this in the top echelon of difficulty, easily. Rockman and Forte is up next. This one is well known as one of the hardest games in the series casually, and it's not much different here. Both stage enemies and bosses come at you hard and fast, and you're in claustrophobic situations a lot. But the weapons in this game are powerful, including the fantastic ice wall utility weapon that also does a ton of damage. Bosses like Groundman require very, very good spatial awareness, and the final gauntlet in this game is quite terrifying, including the chaotic Wily Capsule fight. This is squarely one of the hardest ones in the series, and similar to Mega Man 8, my speedrun experience with this one paid off heavily, and it'd probably be even higher if I didn't have this experience before. Mega Man 9, Inti Create's first classic Mega Man game. This one takes away Mega Man's charge and slide mechanics, which ultimately does simplify a lot of the movement, and the game feels like it's designed around that limitation, so it feels quite fair. The tools you get to work with include the very powerful Black Hole Bomb and Tornado Hold clearing weapons. Most robot masters in this game are quite reasonable with some practice, but it still is a technically demanding game. The final fight is pretty chaotic overall, but the two aforementioned weapons help clear it consistently. Overall, this is one on the easier side, but even a game like this that is technically easier by definition still wasn't easy to finish out. Mega Man 10, on the other hand, was quite a bit more challenging. Mega Man 10 feels much more of a threatening game. The enemy placements feel more like they're out to get you, and you really have to study each stage to know how and where enemy spawns are. Some boss fights like Solar Man and Commando Man have such particular nuances that you have to practice a lot for being able to handle them on the fly. Then there are just straight up execution tests like the aggressive Wily machine fight, or the on-the-fly pattern awareness test from Wily Capsule. Weapon swapping is such a powerful technique, but it's also hard to master, and you really do need to master it in order to play this game with finesse. I put this one just above average for difficulty. Finally, Mega Man 11, the last game in the series, and the last one I completed too. Mega Man 11 is a very technically demanding game, between its weapon swapping mechanics and the new gear system. I had to practice this game a lot to get even decently competent at it, but once the scales tip in your favor and you start to learn how the game works, Mega Man quickly becomes extraordinarily powerful. There are some challenging situations in the game, but no single fight is really all that threatening with some practice. Many boss fights in this game are scripted or semi-scripted. Getting the winning run comes down to having a good game plan and just not messing up any of your inputs, so this one falls basically right in the middle of difficulty. So there you have it, all 12 games ranked. The reality is that all of them are challenges. Mega Man 3 and 7 are in a different echelon of difficulty in my opinion, however. The rest of them are reasonable, but no matter what, taking a run to the finish line is just a difficult endeavor. Even with a lot of practice, there's no substitute for showing up and actually performing the run in one sitting. When I got into doing this no damage challenge for this series, I didn't really know if it was going to be feasible or even that fun. I started with Mega Man 8, the game I was most familiar with. From there, I just kept going, one game at a time. Mega Man games are known for being somewhat difficult, but the reality is that these games are extremely well crafted for no damage challenges. They are hard, but they are not unfair, with one single exception. You can practice, and with good spatial awareness and execution, every situation can be overcome. In my mind, the only unfair fight in the entire series is Doc Quickman, and it's only really feasible to complete because you can intentionally slow down the game by lagging it with projectiles. Every other situation in the series is approachable, and honestly, that's a pretty good track record. The whole endeavor was really fun. I set a strict rule set for each game, I performed every attempt of the runs live, I saved the VODs of every attempt and made them available, and created a summary video for every game. I did it in my way, and I did it in a way that I'd be proud of and that hopefully others would appreciate someday too. This whole saga took a little under 2 years, and was the source of a lot of fun times, funny situations, and rewarding finishes. Thanks to all the people who supported me along the way on this journey, and I had a great time. See you for the next endeavor.